الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا ما بعد. We praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى abundantly the way he deserves to be praised. We ask Allah to exalt the mention and send his peace and blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Brothers, sisters, welcome. We will continue, dive right into the discussion on Surah Maryam. And we are, I believe, at ayah number 46. فتفضل يا مصعب.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. قال أراغب أنت عن آلهتي يا إبراهيم لئن لم تنتهي لأرجمنك واهجرني مليا. قال سلام عليك سأستغفر لك ربي إنه كان بي حفيا. وأعتزلكم وما تدعون من دون الله وأدعو ربي عسى ألا أكون بدعاء ربي شقيا. فلما اعتزلهم وما يعبدون من دون الله وهبنا له إسحاق ويعقوب وكلا جعلنا نبيا. ووهبنا لهم من رحمتنا وجعلنا لهم لسان صدق عليا.
His father said, "Have you no desire for my gods, O Abraham? If you do not desist, I will surely stone you. So avoid me a prolonged time." Ibrahim said, "Peace will be upon you. I will ask forgiveness for you of my Lord. Indeed, he is ever gracious to me. And I will leave you on those you invoke other than Allah and will invoke my Lord. I expect that I will not be in my invocation to my Lord unhappy." So when he had left them and those they worshipped other than Allah, we gave him Ishaq and Jacob, Isaac and Jacob. And each of them we made a prophet, and we gave them of our mercy, and we made for them a reputation of high honor. So here the Shaykh will say, "Now." فَلَمْ يَنْجَعْ هَذَا الدُّعَاءِ بِذَلِكَ الشَّقِيِّ. So this supplication and this invitation was ineffective with this wretched person. وَأَجَابَ بِجَوَابٍ جَاهِلٍ. And he responded to his son with an ignorant answer. وَقَالَ. And he said, أَرَاغِبٌ أَنْتَ عَنْ آلِهَتِي يَا إِبْرَاهِيمِ. Do you have no desire for my gods, O Ibrahim? فتبجج بآلهته التي هي من الحجر والأصنام. So he was arrogant, and he was what's the term? He was I cannot think of the word right now. Subhanallah. Anyways, he was basically praising and feeling contented and conceited with his gods, which were actually made of, he was boasting, there you go, he was boasting regarding his gods, which were made out of stones and statues. وَلَامَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ عَنْ رَغْبَتِهِ عَنْهَا. And he was blaming Ibrahim, how could you turn away from these gods? وَهَذَا مِنَ الْجَهْلِ الْمُفْرِطِ وَالْكُفْرِ الْوَخِيمِ. And this is like when you have compounded a level of ignorance and just like a high level, a high intensity disbelief. يتمدح بعبادة الأوثان ويدعو إليها. He's actually praising the worship of idols and he's inviting the people to that. لئن لم تنته. If you do not desist, أي عن شتم آلهتي ودعوتي إلى عبادة الله. If you don't stop from cursing my gods and inviting you to the worship of Allah, لَأَرْجُمَنَّكَ أَيْ قَتْلًا بِالْحِجَارَةِ, meaning I will stone you to death. وَهْجُرْنِي مَلِيَّ أَيْ لَا تُكَلِّمْنِي زَمَنًا طَوِيلًا, meaning don't speak to me for a long, long time. Subhanallah. Earlier, excuse me, we were reciting Surah Nuh, and you get the same, principles and the same ideology from those people. وَقَالُوا لَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ, and they say, do not abandon your gods. وَلَا تَذَرُنَّ وَدًّا وَلَا سُوَاعًا وَلَا يَغُوثَ وَيَعُوقَ وَنَسْرًا. Don't, they were naming their gods. Don't abandon them. Don't give up on them. And so the people of disbelief, they always want to criticize the worshippers of Allah, and they always want to rejoice the worship of other than Allah. Whenever Allah is mentioned, ishma'azzat, they get disgusted. And then when they, other than Allah is mentioned, idha hum yastabshirun, all of a sudden they become happy and rejoiced and entertained whenever their false gods are mentioned. And this is how it is until the end of time. This actually works on a larger scale in terms of idolatry versus monotheism, and it works on a scale within Islam. When, you know, the people of Sunnah versus other denominations, and we hope and pray that everybody adheres to the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Alhamdulillah. فَأَجَابَهُ الْخَلِيلُ جَوَابَ عِبَادِ الرَّحْمَنِ عِنْدَ خِطَابِ الْجَاهِلِينَ. الله أكبر. So Khalil, Al-Khalil, the close friend of Allah, responded with the response of the slaves of the Most Merciful whenever they are addressed by the ignorant. وَلَمْ يَشْتِمْهِ, and he did not vilify him. He did not verbally abuse him. بَلْ صَبَرْ, rather he was patient. وَلَمْ يُقَابِلْ أَبَاهُ بِمَا يَكْرَهُ, and he did not tell his father that which his father may dislike. وَقَالَ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكَ, rather he said, peace be upon you. أَيْ سَتَسْلَمْ مِنْ خِطَابِ إِيَّاكَ بِالْشَتْمِ وَالسَّبِّ وَبِمَا تَكْرَهُ, meaning you'll be at peace from my speech towards you that may contain cursing or belittlement or any kind of defilement and anything which you may hate. سَأَسْتَغْفِرُ لَكَ رَبِّي إِنَّهُ كَانَ بِي حَفِيَّا, I will verily seek forgiveness, for you from my Lord forever. Forever Allah Azza wa Jal is gracious to me. أي لا أزال أدعو الله لك بالهداية والمغفرة بأن يهديك للإسلام الذي به تحصل المغفرة, meaning I will continue to call on Allah, I will continue to invoke Allah for you to be guided and for forgiveness, and that He will guide you to Islam through which you may attain forgiveness. فإنه كان بي حفيا, because He's ever gracious to me. أي رحيما رؤوفا بحالي معتنيا بي, Allah is merciful, kind to me in my condition, and He looks after me. فَلَمْ يَزَلْ يَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لَهُ رَجَاءً يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ, and he continued to seek forgiveness for him. He continued to ask Allah to forgive him so that Allah may guide him. فَلَمَّا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ أَنَّهُ عَدُوٌ لِلَّهِ, but after it became clear to him that his father is a clear-cut enemy of Allah, وَأَنَّهُ لَا يَفِيدُ فِيهِ شَيْئًا, أَنَّهُ لَا يُفِيدُ فِيهِ شَيْئًا, and that nothing will benefit with his father, تَرَكَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارَ لَهُ وَتَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُ, he stopped seeking forgiveness for him, and he declared his innocence, and he disowned his own father. And that is very important, because we have many other ayat in the Quran about Ibrahim and his father, where Ibrahim said, وَبَدَتْ الْبَغْضَاءَ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ, and enmity will appear and be between us and you until you worship Allah alone. يعني the people, this is the concept of wala and bara, the allegiance to the people of Tawheed, and the declaring the declaration of innocence from the people of disbelief. It's a very black and white subject matter. It's a very straightforward and very serious as well. So you know, I have to know which camp on you on, if we may use this term. وَقَدْ أَمَرَنَا اللَّهُ بِاتِّبَاعِ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, Allah Azza wa Jal has commanded us بِاتِّبَاعِ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, Allah had commanded us, أو بِاتِّبَاعِ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, Allah has commanded us to follow the way of Ibrahim. فمن اتباع ملته سلوك طريقة طريقه في الدعوة إلى الله بطريق العلم والحكمة واللين والسهولة والانتقال من رتبة إلى رتبة. And part of the methodology of following his way in da'wah to Allah is through knowledge and wisdom and lenience and ease and moving from transitioning from one level to another. والصبر على ذلك, and being patient in the process. وعدم السآمة منه, and never giving up and despairing in the process. والصبر على ما ينال الداعي من أذى الخلق بالقول والفعل, and then the patience that the caller will receive from the creation both verbally and in their actions. وَمُقَابَلَةَ ذَلِكَ بِالصَّفْحِ وَالْعَفُوَ And that you should meet that and reciprocate that with pardoning and forgiveness. بَلْ بِالْإِحْسَانِ الْقَوْلِي وَالْفَعْلِي Rather with even excellence in terms of your statements and your behavior. May Allah make us among those. It's a very tough thing, I'll tell you. فَلَمَّا أَيِّسَ مِنْ قَوْمِهِ وَأَبِيهِ When he had given up from his people and his father, قَالَ وَأَعْتَزِلُكُمْ وَمَا تَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ And then I will leave you and those you invoke other than Allah. أي أنتم وأصنامكم, meaning you and your idols. وَأَدْعُوا رَبِّي And I will call on my Lord. وَهَذَا شَامِلٌ لِدُعَاءِ الْعِبَادَةِ وَدُعَاءِ الْمَسَلَةِ And this encompasses both the dua of worship and the dua of need, meaning asking for a particular thing. عَسَى أَلَّا أَكُونَ بِدُعَاءِ رَبِّي شَقِيًّا أي عَسَى اللَّهَ أَنْ يُسْعِدَنِي بِإِجَابَةِ دُعَاءِ وَقَبُولِ أَعْمَالِي Perhaps Allah will make me happy by answering my supplication and accepting my deeds. وَهَذِهِ وَظِيفَةُ مَنْ أَيْسَ مِمَّنْ دَعَهُمْ And that is the occupation and of anyone who has given up on the people that he's inviting. فَاتَّبَعُوا أَهْوَاءَهُمْ And they follow their desires. فَلَمْ تَنْجَعْ فِيهِمِ الْمَوَاعِظِ And so no admonition was effective with them. فَأَصَرُّوا فِي طُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ So they became persistent in their evil ways. They're just wandering in their evil ways. أَنْ يَشْتَغِلَ بِإِصْلَاحِ نَفْسِ After that, then you should work on rectifying yourself. وَيَرْجُوا الْقَبُولَ مِنْ رَبِّ And you should hope and pray that Allah will accept your deeds. وَيَعْتَزِلَ الشَّرَّ وَأَهْلَ And you should just abandon the evil and its people. When you've done all that you could to invite the people and they don't want to accept it, خلاص. Then you focus on yourself. But you never give up on giving them da'wah. That's the idea. وَلَمَّا كَانَ مُفَارَقَةُ الْإِنسَانِ لِوَطَنِهِ وَمَأْلَفِهِ وَأَهْلِهِ وَقَوْمِهِ مِنْ أَشَقِّ شَيْءٍ عَلَى النَّفْسِ لِأُمُورٍ كَثِيرَةٍ مَعْرُوفَةٍ And when a person departing from his land, from his home, and from that which he's accustomed to, and his family, and his tribe, his people, is among the most difficult things upon the soul. And that is for many known reasons. وَمِنْهَا انْفِرَادُهُ عَمَّنْ يَتَعَزَّزْ بِهِمْ وَتَكَثَّرْ And among them is that you're secluded, you're singled out, you're separated from those who you may seek honor through. And you know, with your family, when you have an abundance of family, you feel honored, you feel you have some sort of support. وَكَانَ مَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا إِلَّا عَوَضَهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِنْ And whosoever abandons something for the sake of Allah, Allah will give him something better in return. وَاَعْتَزَلَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ قَوْمًا Ibrahim abandoned his people. قَالَ اللَّهُ فِي حَقِّ Allah said in his regard. فَلَمَّا اَعْتَزَلَهُمْ وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَهَبْنَا لَهُ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ So then we granted him Isaac and Jacob. وَكُلًّا مِنْ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ And both Isaac and Jacob جَعَلْنَا نَبِيًّا We made a prophet. فَحَصَلَ لَهُ وَلِهَؤُلَاءِ الصَّالِحِينَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ إِلَى النَّاسِ الَّذِي خَصَّهُمُ اللَّهُ بِوَحْيِهِ وَاخْتَارُهُمْ لِرِسَالَتِهِ وَاصْطَفَاهُمْ عَلَمِينَ So then that he attained this benefit. And those righteous people, those righteous messengers that were sent to the people, whom Allah has honored by being specified with his revelation, and Allah has selected them for his message, and Allah Azza wa Jal has picked them and favored them over the alameen, over the worlds. وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُمْ أَيْ لِإِبْرَاهِيمُ وَأَبْنَيْهِ إِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ And we granted them, meaning all three of them, Ibrahim, and his children, Isaac and Jacob, مِنْ رَحْمَتِنَا From our mercy, وَهَذَا يَشْمَلُ جَمِيعَ مَا وَهَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ مِنَ الْعُلُومِ النَّافِعَ وَالْعَمَالَ الصَّالِحَةِ وَالذُّرِّيَّةِ الْكَثِيرَةِ الْمُنْتَشِرَةِ And that includes everything that Allah Azza wa Jal has granted them from His mercy, such as beneficial knowledge, righteous deeds, and abundance of progeny. الَّذِي قَدْ كَثُرَ فِيهِمِ الْأَنْبِيَاءُ وَالصَّالِحُونَ Among which there were many among the prophets and the righteous people. وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُمْ لِسَانَ صِدْقٍ عَلِيًّا وَهَذَا أَيْضًا مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ الَّتِي وَهَبَهَا لَهُمْ And this is also from the mercy of Allah that He granted them. لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ وَعَدَ كُلَّ مُحْسِنٍ أَنْ يَنْشُرَ لَهُ ثَنَاءً صَادِقًا بِحَسَبِ إِحْسَانٍ Because Allah promised that every good doer, Allah will spread for that person among the people a praiseworthy comments depending proportional to His excellence. وَهَؤُلَاءِ مِنْ أَئِمَّةِ الْمُحْسِنِينَ And those are among the forefront and the foremost and the pioneers of righteous and good doers. فَنَشَرَ اللَّهُ الثَّنَاءَ الْحَسَنَ الصَّادِقِ غَيْرَ الْكَاذِبِ الْعَالِي غَيْرَ الْخَفِيِّ So Allah spread around the truthful, sincere praise of them that has no lies in it. The one that is lofty with nothing hidden. فَذِكْرُهُمْ مَلَأَ الْخَافِقِينَ والثناء عليهم ومحبتهم امتلأت بها القلوب وفاضت بها الألسنة. So their mention has basically spread all over the world, and their praise and the love for them has filled the hearts of the people and has come out on the tongues of the people as well. فصار قدوة للمقتدين وأمة المهتدين. So he became then a leader for those who need leadership, and he is an imam for those who are seeking guidance. ولا تزال أذكارهم في سائر العصور عصور متجددة. And their mention continues through the generations to be reminded, to be repeated, to be prevalent. وذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم. And this is indeed the virtue and the bounty and the blessing of Allah, whom He gives, the one that He gives to whomever He wills, and Allah is the possessor of the greatest bounty. كمل يا مصعب.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. واذكر في الكتاب موسى إنه كان مخلصا وكان رسولا نبيا وناديناه من جانب الطور الأيمن وقربناه نجيا ووهبنا له من رحمتنا أخاه هارون نبيا.
Okay, and mentioned in the book Moses, indeed he was chosen and he was a messenger and a prophet, and we called him from the side of the mount at his right and brought him near, confiding to him, and we gave him out of our mercy his brother Aaron as a prophet. The Shaykh rahimahullah says, أي وذكر في هذا القرآن العظيم موسى بن عمران. Mention in this great Quran Moses, the son of Imran, على وجه التبجيل له والتعظيم, in a context or in a manner wherein you are boasting about him and magnifying him, والتعريف بمقامه الكريم وأخلاقه الكاملة, and by identifying the people, identifying his noble status and his perfect character. أنه كان مخلصا قرئ بفتح اللام على معنى أن الله تعالى اختاره. So it was recited with the fatha on the lam, mukhlasan, which means that he was one whom Allah has selected. Wastakhlasahu, Allah has chosen him. Wastafahu ala alalamin, Allah selected him over the people of the world. Wa quri'a bikasriha ala ma'na annahu mukhlasan, and it was also recited with the other qira'ah instead of mukhlasan, mukhlasan lillahi ta'ala, ay annahu, meaning he was sincere, annahu mukhlisan lillahi ta'ala fi jami'i a'malihi wa aqwalihi wa niyatihi, he was sincere to Allah in all of his actions, in all of his statements, in all of his intentions. Fawasfuhu al-ikhlas fi jami'i ahwali, so his status, his description is to be sincere in all of his affairs. Wal ma'nayani mutalaziman, and those two meanings actually are coherent, they strengthen one another. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَخْلَصَهُ لِإِخْلَاصِهِ, so Allah Azza wa Jal has selected him and chosen him because of his sincerity. وَإِخْلَاصُهُ مُوجِبٌ لِإِسْتِخْلَاصِهِ, and his sincerity necessitates him being selected. وَأَجَلُّ حَالَةٍ يُوصَفُ بِهَا الْعَبْدُ الْإِخْلَاصِ, and the greatest description that a slave may be described with is sincerity. مِنْهُ الإخلاص منه والاستخلاص من ربه, meaning the sincerity from him and that he is chosen and selected among the elite by his Lord. وكان رسولا نبيا, he was a prophet and he was a messenger and a prophet. أي جمع الله له بين الرسالة والنبوة, Allah has combined for him both messengership and prophethood. فالرسالة تقتضي تبليغ كلام المرسل المرسل وتبليغ جميع ما جاء به من الشرع دقه وجله. رسالة, when you say he's a rasul, that means, that necessitates that he has to convey the speech of the one who sent him, and he has to convey everything that has been brought in the legislation, the minute details and the particulars, the intricacies of it. والنبوة تقتضي إيحاء الله إليه وتخصيصه بإنزال الوحي إليه, whereas نبوة, prophethood, necessitates that Allah revealed something onto him and Allah specified him by getting that divine contact and that divine revelation and inspiration. فالنبوة بينه وبين ربه. So his prophet, the prophethood is between him and his Lord. والرسالة بينه وبين الخلق. And the messengership is between him and the creation. And that is a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful foundational principle that the Sheikh laid down in this tafsir. So when we want to make a distinction between prophet and messenger, we understand that the prophet does not come with a new message. He does not have a new law. So he might be already applying an existing law, and it's between him and his Lord. Whereas the risala necessitates that he has a law that he has to convey to the people in its full-fledged form. And that is a connection between him and the khalq and the creation. Of course, that includes the jinn. That's why I said the creation, because it's ins and jinn. Ayah 52, بَلْ خَصَّهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ أَنْوَاعِ الْوَحِي بِأَجَلِّ أَنْوَاعِهِ وَأَفْضَلِهَا. Pay attention now. Not only that, rather Allah Azza wa Jal specified him with the finest and loftiest type of revelation and the best type of revelation. وَهُوَ تَكْلِيمُهُ تَعَالَى وَتَقْرِيبُهُ مُنَاجٍ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى. And that is that Allah spoke to him directly and brought him near and had a conversation with him. وَبِهَذَا اخْتُصَّ مِنْ بَيْنِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ بِأَنَّهُ كَلِيمُ الرَّحْمَنِ. That's why he was specifically chosen among the prophets to be known as كَلِيمُ الرَّحْمَنِ, meaning the one who spoke to the most merciful. ولهذا قال, that's what Allah says, وناديناه من جانب الطور الأيمن, and we called on him from the side of the mount to on his right. أي الأيمن من موسى في وقت مسيره, meaning that was the mount on the right of Musa at the time of his walk and travel. أو الأيمن أي الأبرك من اليمن والبركة, and أيمن could be from يمن, which is the right, and the right is that of baraka and abundance. ويدل على هذا المعنى قوله تعالى, what strengthens this position is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, أنبورك من في النار ومن حولها, that blessed is the one who's in the fire and the one who's around it. وقربناه نجية, والفرق بين النداء والنجاء أن النداء هو الصوت الرفيع. The difference between the نداء and نجاء, there are two types of calling. النداء is the thin sound, the thin voice. والنجاء ما دون ذلك. And نجاء is whatever is lesser than that. So depending on the level of, I don't want to say the volume, but no, depending on how high the sound, that's why I say munajat bayn athnain, la yatanaja athnain. Two people shouldn't have like a private conversation that is on a very low volume that others cannot hear. على كل حال, وفي هذا إثبات الكلام لله تعالى وأنواعه من النداء والنجاء. And regardless, this has the affirmation of speech being attributed to Allah. Both type of nida and nija, whether it is that louder one or that one which is a private conversation. كما هو مذهب أهل السنة والجماعة, as it is established in the methodology and the path and the way of أهل السنة والجماعة, the people of Sunnah and those who have agreed upon it. خلافا لمن أنكر ذلك من الجهمية والمعتزلة, unlike those who have denied that from among the Jahmites and the Mu'tazilites. ومن نحى نحوهم, and whoever has taken their path. As you know, brothers and sisters, unfortunately, the Ummah is not unified in terms of the belief of the belief regarding the names and attributes of Allah. And you do have many, many Muslims who deny Allah's names and attributes. And some of them go out of their way to change the ayat in the book of Allah because they don't want to confirm or affirm that Allah actually spoke to Musa. Like, it bothers them that Allah spoke to Musa. It bothers them that we're affirming the speech for Allah. And they try to find twisted ways to get out of it. And really, if you submit to Allah Azza wa Jal and accept his speech, and you know that Allah is the best in speech and the most accurate in his selection of words and the most knowing of his creation and the one who intends the best for them and the one who intends to guide them with his revelation, then you wouldn't be really putting yourself in a predicament where you're negating and debating with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَهُ, Allah says in the Quran, the human being has killed himself. May he be killed. What a disbeliever. How much disbelief does he like to get involved in? He's so ungrateful. فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمٌ مُبِينٌ. Then all of a sudden, the son of Adam becomes a khasim. He's an enemy. He's an enemy, argumentative enemy. And we should be submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not debating on these matters. So we accept what the Quran says, that Allah spoke to Musa, and that Allah Azza wa Jal speaks, and that is one of the confirmed and affirmed attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وقوله ووهبنا له من رحمتنا أخاه هارون نبيا هذا من أكبر فضائل موسى وإحسانه ونصح لأخي هارون. This is among the greatest virtues of Musa and his excellence and his sincerity towards his brother Harun. أنه سأل ربه أن يشركه في أمره وأن يجعله رسولا مثله رسولا مثله. That Musa had asked his Lord that Aaron should be a partner in his affair, and that Allah should make him a messenger like him. فاستجاب الله له ذلك. Allah عز وجل accepted the dua of Musa and he gave him that. ووهب له من رحمتي أخاه هارون نبيا. Allah from his mercy granted for him Harun as a prophet. فنبوة هارون تابعة لنبوة موسى عليهما السلام. So the prophethood of Aaron is a follow-up and is connected to the prophethood of Musa عليه السلام. فساعده على أمره وأعانه عليه. So then Aaron truly aided his brother in his affair and he helped him accordingly. يلا يا مصعب.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. واذكر في الكتاب إسماعيل إنه كان صادق الوعد وكان رسولا نبيا وكان يأمر أهله بالصلاة والزكاة وكان عند ربه مرضيا.
تمام. And mention in the book Ishmael. Indeed, he was true to his promise and he was a messenger and a prophet. And he used to enjoin on his people prayer and zakah and was to his Lord pleasing. أي واذكر في الكتاب في القرآن الكريم هذا النبي العظيم. So mention in this noble Quran this great prophet. الذي خرج منه الشعب العربي. الله أكبر. The one from whom came the Arab nation, the Arab people. And I want to take a pause to share with you something important before we mention what the Sheikh is going to mention. Ya akhwan and akhawat, people are of two types. Those that only see things through a racial lens, the glasses that they wear are racist. Those that they wear, even if they don't have them, their lens, their natural lens is a racial one. And they cannot see anything without it. And those who do not see race at all. I am of the second camp. I don't see race at all. I see mankind. Yes, we describe people as being white and black and yellow and brown and I don't know what, in terms of description. But I don't ever in my entire life have I been prejudiced or favored people over people because of their race and so on and so forth. And unfortunately, some of the people within the Muslim community are unable to operate in this manner. They cannot see outside of the racial lens. And so because they've been exposed and treated by other Muslims in this manner, they tend to paint everyone with the same brush and assume that everybody must be this way. But that's transgression and oppression because we're not all the same. Not everybody is like that. And I'm saying this because there have been a few incidents where people try to accuse me of being racist. Remember this whole drama of Abu Tawbah and what's his name? John Fontaine and what have you. And, you know, some people came out and said that, Tahir White, some people said that, oh, you're targeting black people, you don't want to see the black people progress and you don't want them to be the ones who are leading the da'wah and you only target African-Americans or African people in general when you're criticizing them. And I was like, what are you saying? I don't think this way. I never thought this way. And that's actually a bluff. Because I've criticized, many people that were not black, and I've collaborated with many black people. I mean, Brother Sheikh Abdulrahman Hassan, who I have the highest form of respect for, is so Somali, you know? And I don't see him like this. You know, I see him as a fellow Muslim. And I can give you a list of people that I've spoken about or people that I've praised, and it has never been because of race. And recently in this DMX issue, we made this clip, and some sister, supposed to be a sister, her name is Najla or something, is sitting there trying to say, oh, you don't know, you know, the people were brought up and they laced for him, you know, the cocaine or crack with the blunt he was smoking. And so he became, and then the environment is made to, you know, oppress black people and blah, blah, blah. And you have no right. Leave us alone. What do you mean leave us alone? What is leave us alone? Who? What are you? Some other Muslim? Are you a Muslim? I'm speaking from a Muslim lens, ya jama'ah. I'm speaking from Muslim and non-Muslim. I don't see black and white. DMX could have been Eminem for all that matters. All I was trying to highlight was that if the objective was not DMX, the objective was people. I'm showing you that fame, the context of my speech, fame, money doesn't guarantee you success and happiness. And examples of people that are famous and they still struggled and they died, in a terrible death that is associated with depression. And he was a depressed human being because they did not have Islam in their lives, period. How in the world are you thinking right now that because he's black or that I'm criticizing or I'm supporting white America versus black America and his environment? When you're so rich, you can easily, even if somebody laced for you a blunt when you were a kid, you can get out of it, man. Well, I used to do drugs. Alhamdulillah, Allah Azza wa Jal guided me and I don't do drugs anymore. Don't give me this nonsense. Don't give me this nonsense. There's no such thing. Don't blame and don't justify. People are actually trying, in the comments, Muslims are trying to defend DMX. What do you want? What do you want? A person who died upon kufr, khalas, it's been sealed and done. Don't be giving me these philosophies. Oh, brother, what, you were not there. What if he gave the shahada before he died? What do you mean, what if he gave the shahada before he died? That's not how we operate. We wished someone had guided him to Islam. We wished that he had survived. We wished that all this good stuff that you could wish for the fellow human beings. But at the end of the day, it's done. And it's not related to race. So don't try to defend someone because he's African-American and try to give him justification because, you know, you used to listen to his rap music when you were a kid. If I used to have all of DMX songs memorized. That was during my Jahiliyyah when his albums came out. So if anyone is going to connect with this person and know what he, I know his songs by word, wallah, until now, I know them. I have them memorized. So y'all just have to understand that, you know, when you become a Muslim and you want to submit to Allah, you have to make that disconnection from your past and stop giving people excuses just because, you know, they have the same skin color as you, because we don't operate this way. We're all human beings. Either you're good or you're bad. That's the end of the story. As for the Arabs, I've never felt that I'm special because I'm an Arab or that, you know, Arabs are this or Arabs are that. I don't see people with the lens of race ever, ever. So don't ever try to attribute that to me, because I will be your contender on Yawm Al-Qiyamah. I hope I will forgive you in this dunya and the akhirah. But if I need them good deeds, then trust me, I'm going to extract them from you. If you ever claim that I am dealing with people or filtering them or breaking them down because of racial related matters, which is not how I operate, never have, never will, inshallah ta'ala. Now, we all came from a sperm drop. That's how I see it. The Sheikh said, from him came the Arabs, أفضل الشعوب وأجلها, the best of nations and the most noble. الَّذِينَ مِنْهُمْ سَيِّدْ وَلَدْ آدَمْ, who among them is the Sayyid of Walad Adam. Now, I know this expression is going to create some confusion. And just so you know that the scholars, first of all, have differed on the issue. And second of all, a lot of them are of the opinion that the Arabs are superior to the non-Arabs if they believe. If they believe, then they are superior. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah authored a book about this. And many scholars hold that opinion based on certain narrations and based on certain principles. Among them is the fact that Prophet ﷺ came from among the Arabs. And so Allah Azza wa Jal had selected them and chosen them to come from Ibrahim, from Ibrahim to Ismail, from Ismail to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the best of people, the Sahaba were the best of people, and the majority of them were Arabs. So some of the scholars give that favoritism and that superiority to the Arabs over the non-Arabs, not in a racial way, but in a way that they were favored by Allah Azza wa Jal, just like Bani Israel were favored by Allah Azza wa Jal over other nations. But all of this is conditional to them being rightly guided and submitting to Allah. Otherwise, Allah also said about the Arabs that they are the biggest hypocrites. They could be the biggest hypocrites, and they could be the most defiled, the most vile of people, the most vile of people. And we know this from Arabs. The Arabs who don't submit to Allah can be among the most disgusting creatures in the world. I'm telling you this straight up. And I listen and follow a lot of what's going on in the Arab world, especially in Egypt, where you get all these, every other day you get this new atheist, or this apostate, or these Christians. Yeah, Sheikh, Uqsum Billah, each one of them thinks he is a prophet. And they come and run their mouth, and Madri Ash, who they quote, they try to quote the Quran here and the Hadith there, or they reject Bukhari and they reject that. The fact that they are Arabs and they know Arabic actually works against them, because they are now using their knowledge of what accessible information to become among the most wicked of people. So provided that they are submitting to Allah, according to some narrations and according to some of the scholars, the Arabs are superior to others. Personally, I don't know what position to take, but personally, I don't care. Okay, either you're a good Muslim or you're a lousy Muslim, period. But anyways, I'm narrating what the Sheikh said, so don't hate on me. Among them is the Sayyid of Walad Adam, which is alayhi salatu wasalam, Muhammad alayhi salam. Innahu kana sadiq al-wa'd, ay la ya'idu wa'dan illa waffa bih. Allah, fankum, ya akhwan. This is where, I gave a khutbah about this, by the way. I gave a whole khutbah about this particular ayah. He never gave a promise except that he fulfilled it. وهذا شامل للوعد الذي يعقده مع الله أو مع العباد. And that includes the covenant or the promise that he has with Allah and with his creation. And this is, from this you can understand the importance of a punctuality and being committed to when you give people your word, that you fulfill your word. And that is among the worst traits among Muslims today. This idea of, you know, Indian time, Egyptian time, Lebanese time, Filipino time, American time. And what is that supposed to mean? When you ask them, what is that supposed to mean? They say, well, it means if I say that I'm going to come at 8 o'clock, that really means 8:45. Why? Because everyone in their country, supposedly, they cannot commit to the word that they give you. They have to like extend it 30 minutes, 45 minutes, depending on the country. And that is like the justification. Okay, and I just named a few countries, but every person from every country I have met, they gave me the same story. Oh, that's for you. In our country, then it's this much time. Shut up with that stuff, yo. What are you talking about, man? Man, you give your word, you say 8 o'clock, 8 o'clock, you better be there. Unless you have a valid reason that's preventing you from going there. Until now, every football game, every basketball game, every time we have a training, we're supposed to start at 7:30. Usually at 7:20, I'm there. At 7:30, there's another person with me. And then the rest of the people start arriving accordingly. 7:45, 8, 8:15, 8:45. Some people arrive when we're leaving. And it's like, yeah, it's a joke. Hey, brother, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah ala ish, ya sheikh. Alhamdulillah yisalhak. Ya akhi, wallah al-azim, aib. Aib, aib, aib. This is abhorrent behavior. If you promise people something, you better make it happen unless you have a valid excuse. Please, please learn how to be punctual. Learn how to respect people's time. When people are waiting for you, they want you to be there. That's not fair that you arrive late and then you say, wallahi, this is, you know, Balabino time. This country I belong to time. You're a Muslim. There's no such thing as a country dictating how long you should be delayed. As a Muslim, you give a word, you keep it. إِنَّهُ كَانَ صَادِقَ الْوَعْدِ. He was truthful in his promise. Are you truthful in your promise? وَلِهَذَا لَمَّا وَعَدَ مِن نَفْسِهِ الصَّبْرَ عَلَى ذَبْحِ أَبِيهِ لَا. So much so that when Ismail promised that he will be patient regarding his father slaughtering him, قَالَ سَتَجِدُنِي إِن شَاءَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الصَّابِرِينَ. He said to his father, you will find me, inshallah, among the patient ones. وَفَّى بِذَلِكَ. He fulfilled that promise. ومكن أباه من الذبح الذي هو أكبر مصيبة تصيب الإنسان. And he allowed his father to access him for slaughtering, which is the greatest calamity that may befall a human being. ثم وصفه بالرسالة والنبوة التي هي أكبر من الله على عبده. Then Allah عز وجل described him with messengership and prophethood, which is among the greatest bounties of Allah upon a slave. وجعله من الطبقة العليا من الخلق. And Allah عز وجل made him among the highest and the loftiest level and quality of creation. وكان يأمر أهله بالصلاة والزكاة. أي كان مقيما لأمر الله على أهله. So he would fulfill the command of Allah with his family. فيأمرهم بالصلاة المتضمنة للإخلاص للمعبود. He would command them to establish the prayer which included sincerity to the one worshipped. وبالزكاة المتضمنة للإحسان العبيد. And he would command them to establish the zakah which necessitated and guaranteed excellence to the creation. فكمل نفسه وكمل غيره. So he perfected himself and he perfected those around him. وخصوصا أخص الناس عنده. And specifically the people that are most, the closest to him. وهم أهله. And that would be his family. لأنهم أحق بدعوته من غيره. Because they are more deserving of his invitation than others. وكان عند ربه مرضية. And he was pleasing to his Lord. And was to his Lord pleasing. وذلك بسبب امتثاله لمراض ربه واجتهاده فيما يرضيه. Because he used to fulfill anything that will bring about the pleasure of his Lord, and he used to exert himself in that which pleases him. ارتضاه الله وجعله من خواص عباده. Allah عز وجل was pleased with him, and he made him among the closest and the most special of his slaves. وأوليائه المقربين, and the closest friends of his as well. فرضي الله عنه ورضي هو عن ربه. So Allah was pleased with him, and he was pleased with his Lord. I'm going to recite just to cut on time. واذكر في الكتاب إدريس إنه كان صديقا نبيا ورفعناه مكانا عليا. And mention in the book Idris, indeed he was a man of truth and a prophet, and we raised him to a high station. أي أذكر في الكتاب على وجه التعظيم والإجلال والوصف بصفات الكمال إدريس. So then mention in the book in the context of praising and magnifying and exalting the qualities of Idris. إنه كان صديقا نبيا جمع الله له بين الصديقية الجامعة للتصديق التام والعلم الكامل واليقين الثابت والعمل الصالح وبين اصطفائه لوحيه واختياره لرسالته. Allah brought about a combination for him of his صديقية, his truthfulness, which included his full submission, his full belief, his perfect knowledge, his certainty, this firm certainty and righteous deeds. And also Allah combined that for him with being selected for his revelation and being chosen for his messenger, for his message, I'm sorry. وَرَفَعْنَاهُ مَكَانًا عَلِيًّا أَيْ رَفَعَ اللَّهُ ذِكْرَهُ فِي الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah raised and his mention among the worlds. وَمَنْزِلَتَهُ بَيْنَ الْمُقْرَبِينَ. Allah also raised his status among those who are near to him. فَكَانَ عَالِ الذِّكْرِ عَالِ الْمَنْزِلَ. So he was high in remembrance and high in status. Go ahead, Mus'ab, read 58.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. أولئك الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين من ذرية آدم وممن حملنا مع نوح ومن ذرية إبراهيم وإسرائيل وممن هدينا واجتبينا إذا تتلى عليهم آيات الرحمن خروا سجدا وبكيا.
Hey, barakallah feek. Two things to comment. Mus'ab, you don't have to do ta'awwudh every time you recite because this is part of one dars. So next time just commence recitation right away. Secondly, brothers and sisters, you know that there's a sajda in this particular ayah. And it is, according to the majority of the scholars, it is a recommended act of worship. It is not obligatory. So if you don't do prostration right now, that's completely fine. So just to give you that peace of mind. And so you can understand why I'm still sitting on my chair. The Shaykh says, Rahimahullah, لما ذكر هؤلاء الأنبياء المكرمين وخواص المرسلين وذكر فضائلهم ومراتبهم قال. After Allah mentioned these noble prophets, and those specific messengers, and he mentioned their virtues and their status. قال أولئك الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين أي أنعم الله عليهم نعمة لا تلحق ومنة لا تسبق. Allah عز وجل bestowed upon them, a bounty that cannot be followed up with anything and cannot be preceded with anything, meaning it's the epitome. من النبوة والرسالة of prophethood and messengership. وهم الذين أمرنا أن ندعو الله أن يهدينا صراط الذين أنعم عليهم. And those are the ones whom Allah had commanded us that we supplicate to Him to guide us to the path of those whom He has bestowed His favors upon. That's what you do in the Fatiha. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. Those are the ones whom Allah عز وجل has done أنعام عليهم. See, أولئك الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين. And we have this in this ayah and we have it in another ayah. من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن إلى أولئك رفيقا. So we have two ayat that are specifically saying those are the ones whom Allah has given this أنعم عليهم. And these are the ones that you ask to follow in the Fatiha every single day, every single salah, every single rak'ah. وَأَنَّ مَنْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهَ كَانَ And that whoever obeys Allah كَانَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ He will be among those who Allah has bestowed His favors upon among the prophets. الآيَة وَأَنَّ بَعْضَهُمْ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ آدَمَ وَمِمَّنْ حَمَلْنَا مَعَ نُوحٍ And that some of them are from the progeny of Adam. Those were the ones whom Allah, upon whom Allah bestowed favor from among the prophets of the descendants of Adam and those we carried in the ship with Noah and of the descendants of Abraham and Israel and those and of those whom we guided and chose. When the verses of the Most Merciful were recited to them, they fell in prostration and weeping. So just to continue here, أي من ذريتي, meaning from the progeny of Nuh, ومن ذرية إبراهيم وإسرائيل, and from the progeny of Abraham and Israel. فَهُمْ خَيْرُ بُيُوتِ الْعَالَمِ So this is the best households of the world. اِصْطَفَاهُمُ اللَّهُ وَاخْتَارَهُمْ وَاجْتَبَهُمْ Allah Azza wa Jal selected him and chosen them and he praised them. And he gave them that specific kind of attention. وَكَانَ حَالُهُمْ عِنْدَ تِلَاوَةِ آيَاتِ الرَّحْمَنِ عَلَيْهِمْ Their affair, their state when the ayat, when the verses of the Most Merciful are recited upon them, المتضمنة للإخبار بالغيوب, the one that contained information about the unseen, وصفات علام الغيوب, and the traits and the attributes of the knower of the unseen, والإخبار باليوم الآخر, and the mention and the information God in the last day, والوعد والوعيد, and the promise and the threats, خروا سجدا وبكيا, they fell in prostration and weeping. أي خضعوا لآيات الله, meaning they submitted to the آيات of Allah, وخشعوا لها, and they were humbly submissive to them. وأثرت في قلوبهم من الإيمان والرغبة والرهبة and it affected their hearts in terms of faith and in terms of the desire for meeting Allah and the fear of Allah ما أوجب لهم what necessitated that they will البكاء they will cry weep والإنابة and the return والسجود لربهم and the prostration to their Lord ولم يكونوا من الذين إذا سمعوا آيات الله and they were not among those when they hear the آيات of Allah خروا عليها صما وعميانا then they fall in the state of deafness and blindness as Allah mentioned in the other ayah. This is actually from another ayah. So there are two types of people. Either when the speech of Allah is recited upon them, it increases their iman, it makes their hearts tremble, and it makes them fear Allah and look forward and you know yield what is the term? Yearn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and look forward to meeting him, and that will make them cry and be in a state of humbleness and submissiveness. And the other camp is those people that when they hear the ayat of Allah Azza wa Jal, they are deaf and blind. They don't see them, they don't hear them, they don't register with them, they don't make sense to them, they go against them, they debate, they negate, they everything, all the bad traits that you could have. Astaghfirullah. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us among the first group of people. وفي إضافة الآيات إلى اسمه الرحمن دلالة على أن آياته من رحمته بعباده وإحسانه إليهم and from the signs what the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal he added the ayat to his name the most merciful is an indication that his ayat is part of his mercy to his slaves and his excellence towards them حيث هداهم بها إلى الحق so because Allah guided them through those ayat to the truth وبصرهم من العمى and Allah made them see out of blindness وأنقذهم من الضلالة and Allah عز وجل rescued them from deviance وعلمهم من الجهالة and Allah taught them out of their ignorance He educated them out of their ignorance And with this, I will stop because the upcoming ayat are very, very critical. Because in that chapter, I'm going to discuss with you briefly, inshallah, the concept of hukum tariq salah. What is the ruling on the one who abandons the salah? Just so you can have a teaser. The scholars have differed about the subject matter, going all the way back to the Sahaba, actually, even though there's almost a consensus about the one who abandons salah. Is he a disbeliever or is he a disobedient believer? This is one of the ayat that is used to prove one opinion versus the other, the preponderant opinion, I would say. But I will postpone that till next time, inshallah. I know you brothers and sisters enjoy the Q&A and you have a lot to say. So I will give you enough time, inshallah ta'ala, to have your questions put forward. And so with this, we conclude the dars. And bi-idhnillah azza wa jal, we will resume tomorrow. Tayyib, let's see what we got here. What should we do if we have major impurity, can only do wudu? Why? Why can you only do wudu? You have to remove the major impurity. You might be in a situation where it's tough, but from what I know, if you're able to make wudu, you should be able to make ghusl. Even if you're in a bathroom and all that there is a sink, then you could shower yourself, technically speaking, and use some towels, some paper towels, toilet paper to dry. I know people who have been in this predicament before. They were, you know, they had a wet dream and they're in a situation where they can't really tell the people that they need to shower, but they found a way. You know, you go into the bathroom and you handle your business because, you know, ghusl does not mean that you have to, you know, the concept of showering is not that you have to have a shower head running over your head, you know, spraying you all over the place. You could, the Prophet ﷺ actually would make ghusl or wudu with a very small amount of water. That's something that you need to work on. Hey, but that's a tough situation, yeah, Sheikh. Next. Why should we accept hadith? How do we know they are reliable? You should listen and watch my lecture. I hope Mus'ab Mus'ab, can you please place the link in the comments for the lecture, The Philosophers. Watch the lecture, The Philosophers. You will understand why you have to accept hadith. Because without hadith, you cannot pray. You cannot do hajj. You cannot fast. You cannot do most of the acts of worship that you do now. Without hadith, you will not have a comprehensive understanding of the book of Allah. You cannot apply the specifications that the Quran generalized. And you will be a misguided person because you're actually disbelieving in the Quran by not believing in the sunnah, because the Quran commands you to believe in the sunnah. You have to believe in hadith. وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the messenger gives you, so take it. Whatever he prohibits you and prevents you, then leave it alone. How are you going to apply this ayah if you don't have a hadith? Otherwise, Allah would have said, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ اللَّهُ فَخُذُوهُ. Whatever Allah gives you, so take it. Whatever Allah prevents you, then leave it alone. But the Prophet ﷺ, Allah said that you have to do this with the Prophet ﷺ. Now, but the lecture should help you out, inshallah ta'ala. Tamam? Mus'ab, can you post that question that the person sent me an email about and gave three accounts or two accounts on YouTube to ask this question? I want to get it out of the way, please. Is it a bid'ah to do multiple taraweeh congregations? Yes, it is. Yes, it is a bid'ah to do multiple taraweeh congregations. Meaning, if you mean by that you're going to divide it into taraweeh after Isha, then you go home and then you come back for what they call qiyam and you pray another section or another segment and at midnight onwards. That is not how the Sahaba prayed taraweeh. And I am of the position that it is a bid'ah, but I know that the scholars have differed on it, so I'm just letting you know what's up. I am doubtful about a couple of, or at least one Isha Salah, whether I offered on time or not due to a miscalculated midnight time, not calculated midnight time at all that day. What to do? Again, my understanding is if you have missed a Salah and not purposely, and then you've realized that there's an error or mistake, you just make up the Salah. You just repeat that Salah to be on the safe side. Naam. Next. Is decorating the houses in preparation for Ramadan a bid'ah in religion? As I've been saying like this from I've seen a saying like this from Sheikh Sulaiman Rahili. Can you please elaborate on why this is a bid'ah? Well, the reason why some of the scholars will say that it's a bid'ah is primarily because that's not what the Prophet ﷺ did. That's not what the Sahaba did. So there's a simple question. Were they able to decorate their houses with anything? They don't have to have lights and whatever, but they could have put anything up. Were they able to decorate it? Yes. Did they do it? No. So do you do it? No. That's how I operate. And that's the same reason why you will never see me saying to someone, Ramadan Mubarak. Actually, when people tell me Ramadan Mubarak, I don't even know what to reply. Because never ever did a Sahabi say Ramadan Mubarak. And they didn't go around saying Ramadan Mubarak and Ramadan Mubarak to you and Ramadan Kareem to you. And all these expressions that we've become so fascinated with, the Sahaba didn't do it and I don't do them accordingly. And I don't even know how to behave or how to conduct myself when someone tells. And you know, as soon as I get these messages beginning of Ramadan, just delete, 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 delete. It's just delete left and right. Because why do we have to say these statements? I'm a literal in this sense. I'm a literalist. I like to keep it, you know, like Ibn Hazm al-Zahiri in these matters. They didn't do them, I don't like to do them. They didn't decorate the house, I don't want to decorate the house. You know what I'm saying? Those lights we've had before Ramadan, whatever you see behind me, this is all women stuff. You know, as far as I'm concerned, I don't even like those flowers. I don't like the pink in Surah Maryam. I don't like a lot of stuff, but you know, my wife likes the stuff and I just have to be patient. I complain a lot, to be honest with you. But at the same time, you know, I gotta be flexible. But as far as I'm concerned, I don't like any decoration. I don't even like to say Ramadan Mubarak to anyone. And I don't want anyone to say Ramadan Mubarak to me. And somebody sent me Ramadan Mubarak 5 days after Ramadan. I said, Yahi, wait till Eid. He said, at least I remembered you. But now we missed all these questions that were placed. Yeah, anyways, this oldie goldie, brother. Yeah, Sheikh, Allah yahdik yusulhak. I don't know where you got all this information from and why you're confusing yourself and all this inclination or my inclination. Yeah, Sheikh, let me make it very simple for you. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. And your Lord does not oppress anyone. خلاص, أخي, خلاص. You build your whole paradigm, your whole belief system on the fact that Allah does not oppress anyone. No, period. All this shaitan playing games with the mind. But what if, well, the person when he was there, well, Allah made him incline, but Allah created him with the brain going left and then brain going right. Then Allah is going to blame him for choosing the thing the way Allah created him. Ya Sheikh, don't confuse Umm Shagla Ma'ana. Don't delve into these matters. It's none of your business. It's between Allah and His creation. You have to believe, as Allah commanded you in the Quran, that He does not oppress anyone. And so rest assured that everybody will be treated accordingly. That's your position. Know your role. Why are you involving yourself in divine matters? Why are you involving yourself with other people's matters? Your job is to follow the revelation. Anyone who follows the revelation, anyone who submits, Allah knows about them. The people that want to believe, the people want to disbelieve, people want to play games, Allah is aware of the intricacies. يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِ الصُّدُورِ. Allah knows the treachery of the eye and what the chests conceal. And your Lord does not oppress anyone. That's all you gotta know. Whew, get it out of the way, man. I can read Arabic, but I do not understand what I read. But I want to learn how to understand Quran. Where do I start? I answered that yesterday. We said you have to listen to the statements of the scholars. And if you know English and then you know Arabic, then you do what, you know, you follow these type of classes. Because this class will read the Arabic, then I will give you the English, take down notes, print them out if you have to, and start writing notes. Or, you know, buy the or download the English version of this tafsir, for instance, and start correlating the Arabic word with the English word. And you have to study like you study chemistry or physics or mathematics or geometry or whatever other subject. You have to study it and you have to memorize vocabulary. You cannot learn a language without memorizing vocabulary. So that's your mission in life, Kiki B. Kiki B. Sheikh, I'm not a sheikh. Can you please explain Qadr? How does Allah know that I was scratching my hand at this specific moment? How can I understand Qadr? Because every time I think about it, it hurts my head. Advice. Yeah, stop thinking about it. How about that? How about that? How about that? How about that? How about that for a solution? Stop thinking about it. Why are you thinking about it? What business do you have with the Qadr of Allah? Yeah, Sheikh, why do you people make your life difficult? Yeah, Amma, live your life. Allah Azza wa Jal has decreed everything. He knows what you're going to do, but you don't know what you're going to do. So mind your business. Allah knows what you're going to do. Okay, وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ قَدَّرْنَاهُ تَقْدِيرًا وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ. Everything we created with a preordainment. And before Allah created the heavens and the earth, He commanded the pen to write. قَالَ مَا أَكْتُبْ يَا رَبُّ What shall I write, my Lord? قَالَ أَكْتُبْ مَا هُوَ كَائِنْ Write everything that will happen until يوم القيامة. So the pen wrote everything Allah commanded. The خلاص, everything has been decreed. Do you know what has been decreed? No. Does Allah know what's been decreed? Absolutely. What's your position? Mind your business, ya akhi. Why are you thinking about it? Of course your head is going to hurt. At some point you have to submit. Somebody send, please, Mus'ab, put the link for the lecture. Do I have a choice? Put the link to the, I have a lecture on this topic, ya Sheikh. It's called, Do I Have a Choice? Watch it. It's a breakdown of the belief of Qadr, on how to understand Qadr effectively, inshallah. Next. No more coffee. Which should I start the days that I have missed fasting due to sickness or fasting anafil? Allahu Akbar. Can you please fix the English, ya Sheikh? Which should I start the days that I have missed fasting due to sickness or fasting anafil? Of course, you have to make up the days that you missed out. You missed on first before you pray any nawafil. I'm assuming you mean the 6 days of Shawwal. And so, yeah, some of the scholars say for you to be able to fast the 6 days of Shawwal and get the ajr of that, you have to have made up for your days of Ramadan first, because the hadith says, "Man sama Ramadan, thumma atba'ahu sitta min Shawwal." Whoever fasts the month of Ramadan, then follows it with 6 days of Shawwal, فَكَأَنَّمَا صَامَ الدَّهْرِ. It's as though he has fasted his entire life. And so you don't count as having fasted Ramadan until you have made up those days. Na'am, wallahu a'lam. Next. Start with the when prostration ayah comes up. Do I need to wudu to make the prostration? No. You don't have to have wudu to make the prostration of sajda. But obviously, if you read in the Quran yourself, then you should be in a state of wudu if you're holding the actual mushaf. Naam. Is there a way I can personally contact you? Yes. No. Yes. No. Why? I don't know. Depends on what you want. Does smelling black seed break your fast? What? Why? No. No, it doesn't. It does not. Is that a fetish or something that someone smells black seeds? I just want to know whether the dhikr we recite after every fard salah in other months are the same we recite after the same fard salah during the month of Ramadan. Yes, they are the same. Here's Junaid again. Ustaz, can you clear the issue of difference between Nabi and Rasul? I know every Rasul is a Nabi and not vice versa. Was taught every Rasul is revealed the book, but Ismail was called Rasul in Quran. Yes, anytime, I've explained that already. Anytime a messenger is sent to the people to convey to them a revelation or a law, he becomes a Rasul. Now, whether you know this law or you don't, such as the case of Ismail, that doesn't matter. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jal gave him a law and he was commanded to convey to the people, that means that he's a Rasul. Ma'am. Have you tried the new Ruffles flaming barbecue chips? Also, I'm wondering, inshallah, if you can do a fast food review channel. It would really be beneficial for us believers. Thank you. Please tell me this is a prank and you're a troll. I don't eat Ruffles flaming barbecue chips and fast food review. You want me to eat fast food and make a review? What do I look like to you? Ya Nasir bin Ya Uqsum Billah Yibghalak Meen Yalligak Min Arjulak Bis Saqf Fog Wabadan Yisalkha Kida Jaldatain Thalatha Ashan Titadab. Next. Could you recommend some good lectures about the 99 names of Allah and their meanings? There are lectures from Yasir Qadi, Naak, Mufti Mank. But could you recommend some better ones? Better ones? You shouldn't even listen to those. Those are not even good for you to want better ones. Those are actually bad. Those three individuals, all of them are deviants and misguided people. May Allah Azza wa Jal guide them in this blessed night of Ramadan. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to guide all three of them. You have someone like Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah. You know, he called himself Tuwaylib Ilm. He's like a minor student of knowledge. And then you have men call himself Mufti. Look at the world we're living. Someone who gives you 20% of Islam is Mufti. He calls himself Mufti. And Nasir Deer Albani, who has reviewed all the books of hadith and has authored so many books, he considers himself to be a minor student of knowledge. But anyways, that's besides the point. I don't want to go off track right now. Intense, but yes, the 99 names of Allah, there's a book by Sheikh bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah that I think it's called Al-Qawa'id Al-Muthla fi Asma'illah Al-Husna illam takhun al-dhakira. There's a book, and I believe it's available in English and in PDF format, that discusses the subject matter specifically by Sheikh bin Uthaymeen, and that is far better than anything you will get from these individuals. And I know also Muhammad Tim Humble has a series on YouTube discussing the names and attributes of Allah. Now, and those are the people you should be listening to, not those three individuals you mentioned. May Allah guide us and guide them. Is it allowed to do Taraweeh at home reading the Quran on my mobile phone? You should avoid reading the Quran from the mobile phone. However, if you're praying Taraweeh at home because you have a reason not to go to the masjid, and no one is qualified to read from memory, then some of the scholars say, yes, the imam may read from a mobile phone. Now, is trash talking in basketball allowed? Like, leave him open. He is a terrible shooter. Mismatch. Mouse in the house. Yes, I'm. If you know me, then you should know that I am the biggest trash talker you will ever meet. I haven't used those particular expressions. But yes, that is permissible because it is not. You and the people you're playing with are all in this mood and mode of playfulness. You understand what I'm saying? And so it's not like you're actually hurting someone or you're backbiting them and they're not there. You know, it's all said in jest. It's type of joking that is not really, you know, shouldn't be a lie unless he's really a great shooter and you're calling him a terrible shooter. You could always mess around and say, leave him open. He's a great shooter. And you still mess with his brain. Now, and you might fall into lying here and there, but you should avoid that. You should definitely avoid that. But in terms of trash talking, like in your face, and you guys are terrible, stuff like that, it's part of the game, inshallah. It shouldn't be any harm. Ustaz, at the end of Sulam al-Usual, certain letters stand for numbers. The very last lines, like Yusur and Al-Ghufran, can you tell me how these letters represent numbers? I have no idea what you're talking about. I have no idea what you're talking about, Ya Amatullah. I don't know what Sulam Al-Usual is, and I don't know what the numbers are. I don't know what book you're referring to. I have no idea. I'm assuming it's a book. I don't know. I need more info. Oh, we should finish this soon. You mean usul? It cannot be usual. You fixed it with the same spelling, usul, okay. I don't know what that is. I don't know what, you need to send me a link. I'm sorry. But generally, we don't believe in numerology. The whole concept of numbers or letters representing numbers, and so Bismillah is 187 or something like this, or people trying to claim that the Quran has this, all this numerology is inauthentic, is against the Sunnah, and it is not endorsed by Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So I don't know what you're referring to, but if they're trying to connect numbers with letters, then you need to dismiss that altogether. Tamam. How do I tell my mother that? Dude, what happened? How do I tell my mother that reading Kitab al-Tawheed is important and not just reading the Quran? By telling her that it's important. I don't know. I mean, I always struggle with these questions that I find to be... That's your job. It's your persuasion skills. You know, you're asking someone who loves to debate you know, I love being a lawyer, and you know, I enjoy those type of things. But yeah, I cannot tell you how to do it. You have to come up with something on your own. So if it were up to me, I would come up with a million reasons as to why and how I can talk to my mom and how I can deliver something to her and how I could persuade her. I enjoy these events. But it's a skill that Allah gives. It's not like something that it's a blessing from Allah. I can't share with you. I can't tell you here, use it for a couple of days. It's something you have to figure out on your own, really. Allahumma sta'an. Sorry. Next. Quickly, ya Sheikh. Ya Mawlana. Ya Mus'ab, what is said in Islam about vaccination? For example, corona vaccination. We cannot go on Hajj without it, but might be harmful. Wallahi, I am still at odds with the vaccination. And you're not supposed to speak without knowledge. And I don't have knowledge about it, so I will keep my mouth shut. Next. Can you please advise how to have full khushu' in salah? Yes, watch my lecture, Errors in Connection. Can you please post the lecture for him, ladies and gentlemen? Errors in Connection. But basically, you need to bring to mind that you're standing before Allah and you need to know what you're saying. Those are the two main things. Na'am. When is it allowed to hold Quran during Salah? It's not allowed to hold Quran during Salah. The only exception is when you need to pray Taraweeh and you have one imam and that one imam doesn't have enough memorized and so they need to read from the Quran. It was established that one of the slaves of Aisha radhiallahu anha, the slave boys back then, that he, I believe it was Ikrimah. Was it Ikrimah? I can't recall his name right now, that he led them in salah and that he used, a mushaf. Allahu a'lam. Is there a sunnah salat after salatul jamuah? If so, how many rakahs are they? We need to work on our spelling skills. Is there a sunnah salah after salatul jamuah and how many rakahs? Yes, there is. It's either two or four. If you pray in the masjid, I believe it's four. If you pray at home, it's two. When is the time for the adhkar in the morning and evening? The time for the adhkar in the morning is after Fajr until sunrise. And some of the scholars say all the way until Dhuhr. And then in the evening, it's after Asr until Maghrib. And some of the scholars say it's all the way until midnight or Asr, or some of them say it's from Maghrib onwards. But the actual correct position, inshallah, is Asr onwards. Sulam al-wusul ila ilm al-usul. Advice to advise someone to stop lying. He does it due to fear. Advice to advise someone to stop lying. Advice to advise someone to stop lying. Watch my lecture, the four qualities. Somebody post the link for the lecture, the four qualities, please. And it will help you get a better advice on the subject matter. My question was lost, Abu Mus'ab. La ya Ibrahim, it wasn't. How to reflect the Surah Maryam? What Allah wants us to do with the Surah? Well, just listen to the whole series. Allah wants you, not just with Surah Maryam, and with every surah, Allah wants to remind us of how the people of the past were. Allah wants to correct our belief in Him. Allah wants us to connect with Him, to seek His forgiveness, seek His guidance, call on Him alone, not worship anyone with Him, appreciate the righteous people, follow the footsteps of the prophets and the messengers, engage in righteous deeds, stay away from sinfulness. All of these are the objectives of the Quran. Naam. Tayyib, inshallah, the last question for the day is from Brother Yasser Bazzi. Ustad, serious question. How do I get rid of foot fetish? Should I hire my gaze? Hire? Yeah, how much are you going to pay him though? Because if you're going to pay him less than the minimum wage, then you're going to have a problem, brother. Your question is so serious, especially with the typo. Should you lower your gaze? I mean, how do you do? Yeah, if you have a foot fetish, then astaghfirullah, then you're gonna have to treat it like you treat anything else. It's haram to look at a woman's foot to begin with, just for the record. So whether you had a foot fetish or you don't, it's actually haram to look at a woman's foot because that's part of her aura. And so you just need to lower your gaze, bro, and watch my lecture, the poisoned arrow. You're crazy. Na'am. With this, we will conclude, inshallah. He means, should I hire my gaze? What is hire? You look up, yani? What if you see her hair? You should lower your... Oh, okay. So when you lower the gaze, you see the foot. Ya Sheikh, Allah yirham abuk. And when you lower the gaze, it doesn't mean that you don't look at her face, you look at her feet. When you lower the gaze means you look away, ya Sheikh. It means you look away, ya Captain. Allah yahdeek. Lowering the gaze meaning turning away and not looking at her. It's not like shifting from the upper body to the lower body. Hello? It's like, oh, I'm lowering my gaze. Now you're looking at her. I'm gonna put screws in my head and have the jingy bingy come out with the shayateen. Ish hada ya sheikh? You have the misunderstanding. See, this is what this is the problem with the English language. If you take it literally, lower the gaze, like, oh, la, it's deter your gaze. Okay, look away, close your eyes, don't look. It is not okay. It is prohibited. Okay, in Italiano, you understand? Yalla, that's enough for the day. You guys are too much. I need to find me a new crowd. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك أتوب إليك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته